Let me show you how I turned this into this. A much more impressive version of the original shot. And along the way, I'll give you 8 reliable tips on how to achieve epicness in your renders every single time. This video is brought to you by GeoScatter, my absolute favorite amongst environment add-ons for Blender. Stick around to learn about a discount exclusive to the CG Boost audience. Blizzard Cinematics, oh yes. A fount of inspiration for cinematic artists like me. No matter what their games have become lately, I think that these guys are still at the top of the game when it comes to epic spectacle. At one point, and it was in fact this shot from the War Within trailer, I realized they really know how to sell scale in their compositions. But what makes it so impressive? Because, as I've learned when making my Master 3D Environments course, this stuff really isn't easy. And that's exactly where the idea for this tutorial was born. As a little test, I decided to sort of recreate this scene using simple assets and Mixamo mannequins, and along the way, I put what I've learned into simple, followable steps. Before we start, you can also download the project files. All you have to do is to find our free CG Boost resources page and get everything from there. The link is in the description. The very first step that we can do is to go low with the camera. An object towering above you will always be more impressive than if you were viewing it from the top down. Going low with the camera and looking up is one of the surest ways to make your scenes look massive. Sure, it's not always the case. For example, there are these types of aerial shots that can convey a sense of great scale. However, if you really want your audience to feel dwarfed, low angle is the way to go. The widening of the lens, aka shortening of the focal length, always results in more of the scene being taken in, and even more importantly, of increasing the perceived distance between the foreground and the background of your scene. The longer focal lengths tend to flatten things out. In other words, for greater sense of scale, you'll do best to go wide. So here, decrease this number. One of my tricks for animated shots is also to animate the focal length going down a little bit. It results in a subtle vertigo effect, and that makes things even more intense. This tip goes hand in hand with widening of the lens. Wider aspect ratios are reminiscent of epic cinematic shots we know from blockbuster movies. If you want something more impressive than the usual 16:9 ratio, here you can go, let's say, with 2560:1080 resolution, which makes the ratio 21:9. And that gives us the much needed cinematic feel. Beware, you will of course need to adjust your composition to compensate for the cutoff at the top and the bottom. In this case, I added a little camera animation tilting up. Next up, be careful with the depth of field effect. Sure, the effect itself looks very nice. However, nothing kills sense of immense scale as much as using shallow depth of field. If you employ it, no matter the actual size of your environment, everything starts looking like a miniature. In real photography, shallow depth of field is used with lower f-stop numbers and works best in close-up shots and macros. In landscapes, the distances, however, are too large for depth of field to have any significant effect. The only way this could work is actually by focusing on something in the very foreground and then have the whole background blurred. But that's not really what we're after in this scene. But now about the sponsor of this video. GeoScatter is without a doubt my favorite environment add-on for Blender. With the power of geometry nodes, it helps you with quick scattering, but it also allows for powerful advanced distribution, creating whole biomes, scattering rules, and even adding animation and dynamics to everything. On top of that, you'll get access to amazing asset libraries that will help you fill your scenes with realistic flora in a matter of few clicks. I myself have used this add-on on Heroes of Bronze and my other projects, and I simply can't recommend it enough. Now, for the first 200 of you who decide to get it, there's now an exclusive 15% discount. Just type in GeoBoost at the checkout. And if you want to know more about the add-on, I made a 3-part introductory series on my personal channel where you can learn all the important ins and outs of this tool. The links are of course in the description of this video. While we're at the topic of scales, really make sure that your distances in Blender scenes are at least somewhat accurate to real-world scales. So, above all, put some nice distance between your foreground and background, especially the sky. For animated shots, the important concept to keep in mind is parallax. Explained in a very rudimentary way, it is how the distant objects are moving relative to the foreground objects. If your background objects are moving much, much slower than the foreground ones, you'll immediately know they are much further in the distance and thus must be pretty huge. A little side tip, oftentimes when you increase the sizes of your scenes, you will also need to increase the clipping of your cameras to avoid this cutting off of the scene. You can do it in the camera setting here, and in the viewport, go to the view section of the shelf here. Connected to the previous point, it's always very important to give the viewer a scale reference. Let's say if you only had this mountain in the shot, you wouldn't know how big it really is. Sure, you'll assume it's big, but you have no point of reference. However, if you add trees in the foreground, you can start to more or less accurately judge the true mountain size, and especially so if you add the trees even on the mountain itself. Even better, this works with human figures in your scene, a flock of birds, some sort of tents here in the background, or any other element where you can easily judge the scale differences. Watch my other environment video on this channel to know how to enrich your scene with these types of elements and even make your own simulated birds. Nothing tells size as reliably as atmospheric fog. Especially in 2D images, it's one of the best indicators of how distant an object is. I usually just create a huge cube spanning my whole scene, and on it, I put this principal volume shader that I plug into the volume socket. And then I set some very low density here, and occasionally a little bit of emission as well. And that's it. Another element that can really ramp up the epicness of your environments are clouds. You can use them in two distinct ways, either shrouding the tops of your huge objects with them, or adding cloud shadows to your large landscape vistas. In both cases, these were just 2D images with alpha that I put on a plane. And yes, this is a topic of a dedicated chapter in my course, so you can learn all my workflows there. And last but not least, adding small patterns to your scene is super important to sell the scale. For example, lots and lots of tiny little trees and bushes that you fill your scene with. The GeoScatter add-on that I mentioned at the beginning is actually great for this. Or small-scale texture patterns indicating that the bricks these buildings are made of are very small. Or, in our example, these little protrusions and cavities on the sword. Let's compare it with the detail and without it. Add these tiny details to your huge objects and immediately they'll get so much more impressive. And a final reminder, don't forget about the exclusive discount for the GeoScatter add-on that we provide for the first 200 of you who decide to get it. So there you have it. These are my 8 tips on how to make your 3D scenery feel epic. Do you have your own tips? Don't forget to share them in the discussion below. But for now, stay creative, my friends, and until next time, Martin out.